Back in the lion's den. So Charlie's without us today, or we are without Charlie, however you want to look at it. But got the next biggest lion in the kingdom, so to speak. Ronnie, Dennis, Coach Ronnie. How you doing? Welcome.
I'm good. Thanks for having me. Excited to kind of share what's happening, what's going on, and how my role is expanding here.
Yeah, so we've had a period of time where I've been kind of like interviewing coaches and interviewing some even people from outside the gym in some ways for an assistant head coaching position here at the gym. Frankly, because I need help, I need perspective, we need leadership from more than just, one guy in charge. And frankly, when it came down to it, I finally turned around and go, dude, I know you're the humble guy that doesn't want necessarily the responsibility, doesn't feel like he needs that kind of recognition, but you are a leader here and I need your help. You're a good friend who I trust a lot, and I need you to be the head coach here because it's what's best for the gym, it's what's best for me, and I think there's a hell of an opportunity for you here. So in the most friendly way, I kind of twisted Ronnie's arm and said, this is where we need to go. So Ronnie is officially, as of right now and going forward, the assistant head coach here at Nova Fitness and Young Lion CrossFit. Hey! Ronnie, give the people just, I know a lot of the people obviously listening to this know you from as a coach in class, but if you were to give me like a rundown, maybe a little bit on your background, your personal life, whatever else you feel comfortable sharing right now, like give people a little more behind the scenes of Ronnie Dennis.
Grew up right in the city of Rochester, literally right down the street from the gym. I grew up off of Sayo Street, so if you know where that is, you know it's a pretty interesting neighborhood. I saw a lot of things, grew up around a lot of different things, but my family was a very close and tight-knit group. So we did a lot of things together, holidays, events, and those things kind of really instilled in me the pride and the importance of a family and having that community aspect in that. So that carries over a lot into what I do. You know, I'm a husband, I'm a father of four, three daughters and one son, all ages, from toddler to preteen. And, in that space, I try to provide my own perspective and leadership and guidance, and that carries over into what I do in the gym. I played sports my whole life. I've had leadership roles as like a captain and co-captain on different teams. I've coached different sports. I've done personal training since 2011 or 12, somewhere in that space, when I was living in New York City. And when I moved back to Rochester, I wanted to continue in it because it was something that I found a passion in. When I went to college, it was just like, this is the next thing to do. I wanted to own a business, technically really only wanted to own like a sneaker store. But I didn't really need or know that I didn't really need a degree for that. But I learned a lot of different things in my time at the University of Buffalo. But towards the end of my time there is when I really started to dive into like the field of health and wellness and what opportunities were there for me. So like I said, once I moved back to Rochester after living in New York City for a while, it really just was a space for me to kind of double down on personal training. So I worked at two different gyms in the area, Rochester Athletic Club at the time, which is now closed. And then once they got bought out by LA Fitness, one of their locations, I was at LA Fitness for a time. I was just really at that point trying to figure out how to branch out on my own and do personal training and not really be under the umbrella of like a franchise that's only looking to make money and not focus on like the quality of service that's being provided. So I just had a lot of different, what was happening at those companies was not in line with what I believed in as a trainer. So heard about Nova Fitness for a time. I had a couple people talk to me about the location. And once I kind of parted ways with LA Fitness, I actually ran into Matt and Kevin at Knockout Fitness because I just needed a place to train.
I think Kevin used to recruit like good trainers out of Knockout Fitness. That's where he got me, got you. Yeah.
Yeah. So
the breeding ground.
Just saw them there. I just needed a place to work out. There's a couple guys that I knew that were there already, and just like I said, met Kevin and Matt, and just kind of took the jump and leap of faith just to see if that was a space that I can, if Nova was a space that I can come train clients, and that's kind of where I started. Then I started getting ingrained into it a little bit more with like coaching some of the boot camps, and then I think it was, I don't know if it was CrossFit competition first and then coaching CrossFit or starting dabbling coaching. And then it was one or the other. I think it was competition first, then like dabbling and just starting to coach CrossFit. But since that time, that was around 2017, I've kind of been here since and just kind of been around and grown, seen a lot of trial and error. And
Ronnie's been a pretty good job of being the steady hand in a chaotic world at times. You know, like through COVID, through, you know, the last year here, or even all the recovery from COVID, moving businesses. Like, you just, I'm a handful at times. You know, Ronnie is one consistent dude, so I commend you for that.
Yeah.
You know, before we go too much further, I'm curious, like, this is an interesting, so you said you grew up on Scio Street.
Yep.
And I remember one time you were telling me, oh, yeah, man, I grew up in Scio. And I looked at you, I'm like, yeah? I'm like, what's that? And you go, and you just look at me and you go, the ghetto, bruh. And I was like, oh, okay. So sometimes, like, so I, and not to draw stereotypes or whatever, but, like, from what I know you for, like, you are, like, a high character, highly motivated, like, humble, like, but also educated person. So I'm wondering, like, the stereotype of growing up in poverty, like, not the, I don't know if you're poverty or not, but, like, growing up in an environment that is unideal, because I'm from a country, but trust me, it was unideal in a different format. Like, it's hard to break that stereotype, or, like, how you get, like, who did you look up to, or how do you think, I know you mentioned a little bit about family was a big thing, but, like, who do you think had a big influence? Because you could have been another sad story coming from that neighborhood, maybe, but yet you're, like, probably what I would call the prototype role model of a man in America today. Yeah. I know that sounds like, but that's what I think. That's right, honestly, if I had to fucking pick someone for my kid to look up to, I'd be glad it was you. So I'm not like just, you know, stroking your ego. I am curious, like, how did you, you know, what influences got you to like be like who you are today?
I definitely is a family influence, but I think also just, I had a lot of goals. I had a lot of things that I like looked up to. Like I said, I played sports my whole life. So like growing up, I was like the biggest fan of like Michael Jordan, Deion Sanders, like Bo Jackson. And like my dad always had me around either like in a sports league, like a youth league, or I was like watching or going with him to play sports or watch him play sports, whether it's like in a league, a work league for basketball or playing at Cobbs Hill. And I just, we had a really, like I said, the family was really close-knit. So like my aunts, uncles, cousins all had some type of relationship with me where they, you know, I would see them, I would be with them in certain aspects. You know, my few of my uncles worked with the City of Rochester Recreation, so I would go hang out at the rec centers with them. But I think just having the stability of my household allowed me to be grounded in some of the things that I wanted to do and have different experiences that some other kids didn't. You know, I was fortunate.
Did you ever have any like family mantras or like, you know, slogans your dad or uncles or aunts would like, rip off, kind of like like almost like to reinforce what they were teaching you?
See,
just curious.
None that I could really think of. I would say probably if there was anyone that my dad talked to me about a lot, because I would sometimes not make the best choices or decisions. He was just telling me, like, you know, life was about choices and everyone has a consequence, and depending on, you know, which way you go, you got to deal with the consequences that come with it. So that kind of stuck with me. But I think, like I was saying, that stability, like, I grew up, my mom's side of the family is from Puerto Rico. My dad is from, like, Mississippi, and he's, you know, Black, African-American, whatever you choose to identify as. But he's Black. So we just grew up, you know, I grew up with two different cultures, but they're very similar in, like, a lot of the principles and things that I grew up with. Like, I grew up on one side of Weld Street, but then my grandmother, my dad's side, was on the opposite side of Weld Street. So I would be up and down the block, like, traveling between my home, my grandmother's home. And, you know, it was, you know, my grandmother was no nonsense, but she was very nurturing and caring. And my mom was kind of the same way, but they both did it in, like, different ways. You know, I used to get called a square in the neighborhood because my mom would, like, come down the block screaming for me to come home because she knew, like,
I've been there.
She knew, like, at a certain time, a certain hour, I shouldn't be outside with the group of kids that were out there. Yeah. You know, in my neighborhood at the time, and it still, unfortunately, is the same. There's a lot of crime, drugs, sold and used. Violence, and, you know, sometimes you just had to fend for yourself with your peers. But as we got older, you know, the stakes kind of changed, and I could have easily just got myself into that world of some type of illegal activity or whatnot. But I just knew the risks that came with it, and what I wanted for myself was not worth the risk that took. So, you know, I knew I wanted to go to school, college. I knew I wanted to be, at some point, a family man. And, hustling on the block was just not.
What age did you think you
knew that? Oh, I think, like, late single digit age. Like, by the time I got, like, second or third grade.
Really? So you're thinking.
I don't know. Because I just knew, like, at that time is when I really, really started to get into sports. Like, I used to draw a lot. I had my cousins that were, like, into art. My uncle was into art and a lot of different music as well. But I think playing sports and seeing, like, how these athletes at that time would carry themselves as, like, men, so to speak, that kind of left a big impression on me. And, you know, I'm a fan of, like, Atlanta Braves, Florida State football because of, like, Deion Sanders. I'm still, like, fan of Chicago Bulls because of, like, Michael Jordan. And, like, those guys were, like, big, big, almost idol-like things to me. And, like, I say that, like, loosely. But they just left a big impression. It was like, all right, like, I want to go to Florida State for college because, like, it's a, like, great school in the 90s for football, and I want to play football. So it's like, all right, I'm not going to let anything, like, deter me or steer me away from, like, that goal. And, you know, those different things like that would be, like, kind of my own, like, motivation or intrinsically how I would, like, keep myself, like, try to work hard. And then, you know, outside of, like, my mom, like, you had to hold certain standards academically. Like, she wouldn't let me struggle in school and still participate in some of the things I wanted to do. Like, so there were standards on her end. Like, my dad laughs. I even, like, talk about it with my daughter recently. She's got, like, a 3.9 on her first report card, and she was mad because she wanted a 4.0. And it reminded me of the time when I got, like, a 3.8 my freshman year in high school. And my dad was like, you know, you messed up. Because now your mom knows that you can hold these grades, and if you slip under that at all, She's going to be on you about it. Well, so it's just like higher standards I was held to. So it's like if I have to do it and I know I want to play sports, or I want to have the freedom to do those things that I enjoy, like I have to meet those standards. So
yeah. You know, the other day, the funny story, I don't know if this is because you have daughters or because of maybe the way you just raise them or set the standard for your own kids. And this is no criticism of anyone else's kids. So Harry and Wes come in. They see the kids' pen, you know, that we set up. They start running wall to wall, WWE style, off the ropes, and which is funny, you know, just kids being kids. Your kids come in and they see the whiteboard. They start writing their times tables and practicing their cursive or whatever. And I was like, "What the hell?" Either this is the difference between boys and girls, or Ronnie's got his kids on a tight, tight rope. And I was just blown away. I was like, "Holy shit!" You know, the age differences too. You know, but. It was just maybe.
My kids let loose, but they also know, like, when I let them know, like, if it's open gym, like, have fun, run around. But, like, if it's a class going on, just, like, they know from even before having the little kids, then now it's like you have your space to stay in, and that's where you should be during this time. Once the class is over, there's a freedom for you. So just kind of holding them to an expectation and, you know. They'll slip up, you know, because they're kids and they, you know, push boundaries or whatnot. But just try to be consistent with it so that they know every time, like, there's nothing changing, like, so they know what to expect.
Sure. So you mentioned, consistency and stability, like, kind of was a big part of your household growing up. And I think that's actually a good point because that's kind of some of what you provide to us here at the gym. You know, you're a consistent person, stable, reliable, you know, open. So I want to talk a little bit more, obviously, about your new role, like what you're going to do. Now, some of the things, we haven't actually worked out every aspect of every detail, so it's a little new. But, you know, one of the things, you know, I needed and I needed help with from Ronnie, it's, you know, just having perspective on, are we running this program right? Am I missing something? Do I have blind spots I don't see? You know, what do you think? And because I know a lot. I've been around this business a long time. I've done it full time for years and years. I've worked in a lot of places, got a lot of education, yada yada. But I'm not so arrogant to think that I don't miss things. And so having somebody who I trust, not only just as, you know, a person, but also, like, I think has a shared vision for how I see things. I noticed over the years, you know, being friends with you, being competitive teammates with you, like, we have a, like, I don't know how to describe it. It's not like we sit around talking about it, but we, like, see things the same way a lot of times. I feel like you see things when I see them, right? Bounce an idea off you, and then you're always, like, you know, right on it. Or I almost know what you're going to say, but I double-check anyway. So I was curious, maybe you could elaborate for some of the people and just reinforce some of your thoughts, or maybe even mine. Maybe some of your training philosophy, some of your beliefs on coaching or CrossFit, and how we run the program here, and where you like to, take it.
Right.
So I guess, maybe some, what are the foundational principles you operate from to start with?
Yeah, so I'm big on, just as a person, as a human being, I'm big on, like, integrity, like, doing the right thing because it's the right thing to do, and then seeing people as, like, I guess humans first, like, you're a person first before anything else, and I need to respect you as, like, at a base level because of that. Like, and then from there, as we develop in our relationship, you know, if there's things that we maybe don't see eye to eye on or we can disagree on, as long as we have, like, that baseline level of respect still, we can still have our differences of opinion. From there, you know, if I dive into, like, my philosophy on coaching, is kind of built on that, you know, my goal is to help people. And that goal in helping people is I have to respect where they're coming from, what they want out of the help that I'm able to provide for them, and how I can get them there. So I like to be, I think of my philosophy as getting people to make progress. So, you know, we program on a progressive lens with a lot that we do with helping develop skills, getting people stronger, not just like so randomized things. And then from there, making it fun. Training can become monotonous. I can enjoy monotony because it's like the work has to be done, but I know for some people they just need a mix. So we try to make it as fun as possible within the CrossFit classes. Also, the same thing I apply with my clients, but also making it inclusive so that everybody has something that they're working towards and they're not just an outlier because they don't have a certain skill set or can't do a certain thing. And what was the last piece I was going to add to that? I can't remember. Oh, man. Those things are basically are like a foundational principle that I try to build everything off of, as somebody in a space where I'm leading a group or leading someone towards what they're looking to accomplish. And people are almost like relying on me for that. And they're trusting me. And I take that pretty seriously because... that's not something that I think you have to, you can look at and kind of brush off as like something small. Like somebody's putting their trust in their health and your knowledge of what you're able to, challenge them with in a way that can be and will be life changing. Whether yeah. it's like physical health or just like a mindset space or just like social emotional.
And that's sometimes like I think it goes overlooked. Like we have staff meetings pretty regular, every month at least. And like what you're talking about is something we actually address as a group. Like how serious it is, just like you're saying, this is somebody else's life. They come in, they want to do CrossFit, they want to exercise. Yeah, I mean, some people want to do it for vanity and for just a sport, but some people do it because their like life depends on it. Like it makes them feel good. It helps them with their mental health. It helps them with their physical health, obviously, so they can be there for their families. Like, and so like in the same way, if somebody goes into a doctor's office or a nurse's office or something else, like a doctor hopefully is taking this patient seriously every day. Like every time a new patient comes in, they take them serious and they treat them with that kind of respect, like you were saying. Everything that each person's case by case individual, but like, not everything is for everyone all the time, but we try to have that approach as a training staff. And we try to, we have new coaches come on. We try to like, we joke, we have fun, it's not that serious. It's right. just exercise,
right.
but also it is that serious. It's someone else's life. So we take those things into serious consideration. I'm glad to hear you say that. And we've talked about it too many times, like just like you were saying, like this should be fun. People right. don't want to do things that aren't fun.
Right.
I mean, you could have the best training program in the world, but if it's fucking sucks to do, you're going to get less results.
Yeah.
So you got to figure out, you got to use the art of training and the art of programming and all that stuff to make it fun at the same time.
Yeah.
Which is... no doubt hard.
Yeah.
Because the most productive training sometimes is the most boring.
Yeah. It becomes, like I said, monotonous. And it's like, all right, I got to do this again. And, some of us, like, it's very easy for us to just, like, rely on the things we're good at and just, like, double down on those. But, if you, get out of that comfort zone and really push to where you're weak, you'll see some progress. Like, I know, early on, overhead, anything was, like, trash for me, especially if I had to like squat a weight overhead. But it was a challenge I embraced, and like Matt can attest to how much progress I've made with it just by literally sticking to it and like following through and showing up on those days, like yeah. embracing like.
Well, you're gonna be a good example of like you're an athletic, strong dude, healthy, just looking like a chisel, jacked up dude some days. But there are still things that are a pain in the ass struggle. Yeah. And, like, you can't let those, like, setbacks or things you're bad at discourage you from, like, making the most of what you are good at. Because most people, when they come to CrossFit, even if they're a little overweight, even if they're not the healthiest they want to be, you're still something. You're still right. strong, probably. Yeah. Or, you can do, you have things you can do better than others. And it's like, stop looking at everything you can't do. Look at what you can do.
Right.
And then make up the difference. Because, like, you were saying, you struggled overhead for a little while. I've seen like snatching or overhead squats were always tough for you, but it never deterred you from like showing up on snatch days. You just knew it was going to be the day you had to eat a little bit of the shit sandwich. But you're so much better now than you were before. Right. Day one, when you showed up to work out with me and Kevin to get ready for like the Catalyst Games, like 2017, Ronnie was just showing up doing strict handstand push-ups, strict muscle-ups, and didn't know kipping was like an option. Meanwhile, I'm barely ahead of him in the workout, like doing kipping, everything. And like, I realized, holy shit, when he figures the rest of this out, he's going to be really good. You know? So it was like, you came in not really knowing CrossFit, but you certainly had a ton of ability in certain areas. And I think sometimes if you were to sit there and focus on everything you didn't know, you'd be like, fuck this is way too hard. Like, I don't want to do all this. Rather than just be like, all right, what do I got to learn first?
Yeah.
Which I think that could be applied to like other people, you know, especially in health.
For sure. People. And just life in general. Like,
true.
You got to take on challenges. Like, if we just run into everything that's comfortable for us, it, like, you're missing out on so much more that you could, like, experience. So, you know, don't be afraid to just do something different, try something new, and kind of don't dabble in it. Like, if it's something that you really want to, like, work towards, see it through.
For sure. Travis has given us the 2-minute warning, so that means we switch out film soon. But no worries on him. We'll just talk over it. Well, so in the time you've been here at NOAH Fitness, give me some feedback. If you were to summarize your experience from when you started to now, if you were to kind of like, I don't know, what are your thoughts? And this is a genuine question. I didn't ask you this beforehand, so if you need a moment to think about it.
No.
But I am curious, and I've asked you and other coaches things at times, like, hey, are we on track? Like, are we doing anything right? Am I right with this? Am I wrong? Let me know what you think. What do you think? And if you were to sum up the last, what, probably 7 years at this point?
Yeah. I think if I can sum it up in like a couple words and kind of expound on that, maybe just like one word I think that jumps out to me is like complex. Like, we had a lot, like early on, there was just like a lot of, I didn't know a lot about everything. I just kind of like jumped in. Like I said, I started with the boot camp. And then from there, when I jumped into CrossFit, it was like, all right, well, I'm going to start taking classes to really learn and understand a little bit more. I had a pretty solid understanding of some of those things because I would follow different, like, programming pieces from different, like, camps of in CrossFit, like CrossFit Invictus, Misfits. And those things kind of gave me ideas of what was what. But coming into NOAH, there's just a lot of different faces at that time. And I was just trying to learn a lot about what I didn't know and relied a lot on, like, Matt, Kevin, and, like, even Katie, too. Just, like, trying to learn a lot about, like, coaching the classes, what the movements were. But early on, we did a lot of, like, building up on our staff. So we had new people coming in, like, not long after I got in. And, like, staff meetings were built on making us better as a group and as individuals. So we did a lot of, like, team building, like, book assignments, reading different books to make us better as a team and as an individual in our role on the team.
You know, one of those things with, like, how we used to assign books to coaches and stuff, or assign every, like, a monthly book to
every, right.
The reason we don't do that anymore is because all of you guys actually just read books on your own. So, like, it's like almost like I don't need to mandate, like, personal development, because you guys are all doing it,
right.
Which is really something to be proud of, and it's pretty cool. But it's like, not that the guys weren't, I think, like, you know, five, six years ago, it's like you just didn't know where to look for the personal development.
Right.
No, so many of you guys have been coaches for so long and part of the team for so long, you get what the vision is, and you know where to go looking for, you know, the knowledge you want. But I just think that's an interesting perspective. It's like, the reason we don't do that is because I'm like, yeah, Andrew and, you know, Ronnie and everyone, they're reading books already. I don't have to, like, tell them to do it. Like, it's like part of who they are, and that's why they work here.
So, but that, I say all of that to say, like, that was, for me, left an impression, like, all right, we're looking to, like, really, like, move the needle in terms of, like, the type of service being provided to you know, the members in the community. So that was like, all right, like, I can buy into this because, like, we're trying to make ourselves better humans. And then, like, things just kind of, like, grew like were growing fast and things were moving kind of fast. And I was still trying to find my way of like, how can I contribute with the responsibilities that I have with my family and my other job? What ways can I still like feel like I'm leaving an impact on in the gym and while I'm here and when I'm not around, because I'm not around as much as I wasn't around as much as some of the other coaches. Like when I'm not around, people still know like I have some type of influence in the gym. So I just, you know, continue to try to immerse myself in a lot of different things and offer my insight and previous knowledge that I have, or my thoughts on training and programming and how it relates to what we were doing. And a lot of ups and downs. I kind of pulled back a little bit. We had right before or like during COVID, we had a little dissension between the team with some of the coaches. That was kind of discouraging to me.
Compounding stress of 2020.
Yeah.
Added up and we're rebuilding. Yeah.
So that for me was like disheartening and disappointing. So I kind of took a step back a bit and focused a little more on my family. Still trying to be around the community, but not, optimizing my role.
So one of the biggest things going forward, so speaking of your role, obviously you'll be part of programming. There are certain things we'll work out, like you're going to be part of programming some of the workouts and stuff. You'll be overseeing some of the potential programs we'll be running. But also, holy crap, did I just draw a blank? Oh my gosh, I just had one of those moments where your brain goes blank all of a sudden at the end of a sentence.
I don't know where you're going with it.
Oh my God. Oh, because you're going to become you're working to be a full-time personal trainer.
Again. Right.
So, Roddy's been part-time. He's worked at, is it still Hillside?
Yeah, Hillside Work Scholarship. Yep.
So, the ideal situation here is Ronnie builds up his personal training clientele. By March 1st of this year, you're going to be kind of making the leap from that job into full-time personal training. So, hey, y'all, if you know someone who needs a one-on-one client or wants some personal training for any reason, whether it be sports performance or health, Ronnie is your guy. He's looking for clients as we speak, and we're looking to give him a good boost, get his business off the ground the way it should be so he can make a good living and also help, obviously, as many people as possible.
Right.
So share with your friends and family. So when you take on personal training clients, typically do you have a format of how you know who you're looking for, or maybe the type of people you'd want the most, or you think maybe the type of people that would get the most out of what you teach?
Something I'm still, I think, trying to, like, hone down, like, the exact type of person. But I think somebody who, for me, is open to change and embracing the challenge of that change. Somebody who... I don't want to say they know what they want, but they kind of have an idea and they're just looking for that guidance. Like, I don't expect, I tell some of my clients, like, I don't expect you to stay with me for the rest of your life. Like, would it be great? Yes. But my goal, like I said before, is like to really teach you and understand like that when you'll get to a point, and I want you to get to a point that you have the confidence to be able to go into any gym facility and know I can do these things confidently, and know I can still like create a change, create a positive change and impact on my health. Those are the things that I look for in my client. It's like somebody who can really take that on and take it with some seriousness too. Like, I don't want it to be like a fair weather thing where you know, something, life gets a little difficult and it's like easily, like, dissuaded from like coming into the gym. Like
as soon as life gets inconvenient, their health and fitness becomes a bad thing.
Yeah, like I'd show up, like embrace, like, all right, this is gonna be a challenge, but this is the one thing that I have control over in this moment. And I'm gonna show up for myself. Like, we have to, there's something that I've talked to, you know, friends and even like my family about, like, having some type of selfishness with your time, not to a point where you're like pulling yourself away from, you know, other important things and other people that like depend on you in their lives. But it's very easy, I think, in our society to like continue to like pour into everybody else. And then when you continue to pour, nobody's pouring back into you. So sometimes you gotta, you know, give yourself the first, fill your cup.
Degree, in my opinion, a person has to like learn to defend their own health.
Yeah.
You get to prioritize it. And like, it is a sad thing. Like, I think a lot of trainers could say the same thing. You as a trainer pour into this person to help them get results, help them get health. And they make some progress. But then as soon as something else comes up in life, financial or family situation or financial situation, something, and things happen, all of a sudden, the health and fitness that you've been working on with them becomes like the back burner thing. And they're like, well, I don't have time right now to take, you know, personal train or pay or whatever the reason, or come to CrossFit. And you're like, but this is the one thing that makes you good or makes you able to do all the other things. Like, and it's like, I think a person sometimes needs to learn to, like, your health and wellness, like mentally and physically, you need to safeguard. You need to decide that, hey, this is the line I don't let.
Yeah, not compromise.
I don't compromise on. Like, I always do my workouts. I try to eat my best. You know, Christmas Day, yeah, I eat a lot. like every other day. You're eating good because it's like a safeguard that allows you to go somewhere on command or play with the kids or just anything you want, really.
Yeah.
I always use the example of one time I was in Washington, D.C., and I was with my old ex-girlfriend. We're touring all the sites, statues, monuments, museums. And it's like 92 degrees with like 95% humidity.
Yeah.
I mean, it is hot as shit. I am sweating. We're both sweating through our shirts from like as we go from place to place.
Yeah.
Anytime we get into a museum, we're just like, oh, the precious cold air.
AC.
But there would be people out there that were 50, 100 pounds overweight, just literally waddling. And I mean, that immense heat, that humidity. And I would just be like,
this is rough.
This has to be horrible for you.
Yeah.
Like, this, you cannot enjoy this vacation if you're on a vacation. You know what I mean? We were on a little trip for fun, and it was hot as it was. We were still fine. You know what I mean? We were pretty healthy. But I would look at these other people, and I go, I feel bad for you. Like, you can't enjoy this.
Yeah.
Like, going and sightseeing in the middle of the day in a hot state is, like, a different experience. Like, I would want to help those people.
Right.
But also, like, it gives you perspective on, like, I need to make sure I keep what I have as best I can, because if I ever lose that, I wouldn't want to have those same struggles. If that makes sense. But
I've had a similar experience in DC too with my wife. Like, we went down for our anniversary and visiting all the monuments, like, so hot. Like, stayed in the museum for way longer than we needed to, just because it was like the AC.
The museum AC is on, right?
But like, coming back to what Matt was saying, just about those people, like, that, I think that's one of the biggest reasons I'm so big and passionate about health and wellness, is because I grew up in a family that had any disease that you can think of, I've probably not far removed from it with my family members. You know, so my mom hasn't worked since I was like single digit age, dealing with like carpal tunnel arthritic conditions in her hands, but she's also dealt with diabetes, again different osteoarthritis issues that affected her entire body, obesity and whatnot too. I've seen heart disease, I've seen heart attacks, I've seen alcoholism, cancer, anything that you can think of, I've probably had family members that have dealt with it, had a diagnosis in it. So those things, like even as far as like my cousin at 17 years old was diagnosed with cancer. And I saw him go through his like treatment for it, and now, you know, he's been believe in remission for that for a while. Just had a little issue with a heart condition, but he's, you know, lost a lot of weight, done a lot of work in the gym on his own to, you know, take advantage and take, you know, control of his health. And those things are why I'm so passionate about what I do with coaching and leading in this field of health and wellness. Like, I want to, like, well, as a kid, I had, like, a goal. Like, I want to live as long as I can. Now, like, as I've grown older, that's kind of evolved into I want to be able to control as much as I can control in my health and help other people build that same ability, you know, that just had such a profound, like, what's the word? Such a profound impact on me that I want to be able to have an impact on others in how I approach, you know, what happens in this gym.
I think too, like once you've had like a personal experience like that where you see the value in health and wellness, and you it's like I don't know how else to say it, but like, if you knew what I knew, you would do what I do because I've reaped the benefits of doing things a certain way, whether it's eating a certain way or training a certain way. And like, you just want, like, at least I do, you know, you want other people to experience how you feel, or, you know, or at least feel better about themselves. And sometimes I used to say, that's how I would explain to people what I did. People would be like, what do you do for a living? I'm like, I'm a health and fitness coach. I help people feel better about themselves.
Yeah.
And like, obviously that's tied to actual results, right? You know, weight loss or muscle gain or, you know, blood pressure and all those other statistics, you know, triglycerides improvements like that, you know, measurable, what do you call it? Attributes or what, metrics or whatever. But, you know, it's because of what you feel, or at least what I felt in my own life. And I want to put that on, you know, want to show other people. So,
yeah, I think that's one thing, like people, like the excuses of like time and stuff often become the reason why people don't come in. But I think it's also like the lack of confidence in their ability to know what to do. And it's like, sometimes I see myself like, I am teaching you and I'm going to help get you to a point where you have some knowledge, and whether it's like at a baseline level or even deeper into it, where you have that ability to now do it on your own. And then we can up the ante in a sense, like now you've learned how to, you know, move your body well. Now let's see how you can move your body with like load, or how can we increase your ability to move longer or for longer periods of time. You know, those things are like, those become the new challenge for me, because like I have to teach you how to do it.
Yeah.
And then that should be the new challenge for you too. Like, all right, I'm doing something else that's like stepping up to that next level.
And sometimes there's different types of clients. Like, right, there's the client that could come in, never like think, never learn, but do anything you say every time they're there and get results. Or there's the kind of client who comes in, they want to learn and master everything you tell them to do. Yeah. And both have different pros and cons.
Because
like some of the best clients I've had with the best results are the people that come in, they want to learn everything. Yeah. They're like, they're writing it down. They're, if I say eat 200 grams of protein, they eat 200 grams of protein, not 201, not 199. Yeah. Like they're dialed in. But also there's something to be said about the person who just comes to CrossFit class or comes to personal training session and just does whatever the coach says. Because if you're dialed in as a coach and you're thinking about their plan and you're maybe they're doing some remote programming for you too. You're like, if you dial everything in and they just do what you say, they still get results.
Right.
And so it's like you can do both, but both of those require a dialed in coach.
Right.
There's no complacency allowed in our business to have success. And I don't think anyone who is truly complacent on purpose can have success. I've seen a lot of trainers that they do it for a while and then they realize, oh, this is real work. Like to maintain this, to make a real income, you have to not only know the topics, but you have to like consistently produce week in, week out, day in, day out. And that's the hardest part. Now, somebody like you who's made it 10, 11 years in this business, even part-time, full-time at different points, like, you know. Like, without generating result, you can't make it. It's not even fun to do if you can't.
It becomes, it's almost like a, it becomes like almost like a burden in a sense. Because I've been to those places, like, especially when I was transitioning out of my time as a full-time trainer when I left LA Fitness and whatnot. Because I took a little time when I was, before I could join Nova, it was like almost 2 years I wasn't like training with like clients with any consistency. And it was like, I could have easily just like gave up on it and like let my like certifications just expire and whatnot. But I still had that belief, and I know my skill and my passion for it would like lead me back to that that space at some point in time. So I just kind of just held true to it and just knew, like, you know, lead by example, follow through, you know, people will still like see that you're doing what you're doing and still, you know, inquire. So I'm just like, don't give up on it.
For sure. You know, that fits a lot into like one of the things I want to talk about. Like, so, you know, like obviously with changes in the business here, obviously like your role is intentional. Like, I need other people stepping up into leadership roles and stuff. There's too much going on. There's too many people to take care of. You know, there's to not have somebody like you maximizing their potential. But the thing I wanted to talk about was like this concept of pride mentality. Like, so we use, you know, Young Lion CrossFit. We're going to tie a lot of analogies and a lot of metaphors through like lions and pride's lions, things like that. But a pride mentality starts with, we're in this together. Like, every one of us relies on the others to do their job so we can all prosper. You know, each one of us has a role, and, you know, it's up to us to fulfill that role. So part of me, I understand that, like, I have a lot of responsibility as, like, being the person in charge or the leader of the quote-unquote pride, but there's no question in my mind that I can't do it. I can't take care of everyone. I can't help everyone on my own. I need more people. That's part of my pride mentality, is, like, it's not about me. I have a role, you know, whether it be an important one or not. I take it real serious. And so this concept, I actually want to talk, we'll develop this concept more and more, but like, I was curious some of your perspective on how you see yourself fitting in with that pride mentality and some of the rules you have or plan to have going forward.
Yeah. I'm very big on just like showing up. Like, if you have a role or responsibility or something, like, take it to heart. Leave no question about your work or quality of work. Those things kind of are very important for me or to me. So I think just in that same space, like with, you know, the way I try to approach coaching when I'm in the gym, I try to hold myself to that standard. You know, I fall short, I may meet the standard, but I know I'm going to just show up and I'll give the best that I can in that moment. You know, and now taking on this new role, it's another challenge for me to expand my reach and expand myself and my influence in this gym. You know, even if it's not a exact thing that I'm doing, just like my presence and the way I carry myself, if that creates a positive influence for members, I think that leaves, that builds in that same way. We're building that mentality that we're looking to, you know, everybody contributes to something, everybody has a role to play in this space to allow us to all grow, not only in the aspect of the business, but in the aspect of the community that we have here. I think we have a strong group of people that are here in the gym, and you know, the core of our group, I think, have, despite some of the transitions and changes and things that have occurred, they're still willing to trust in the vision that we have and the coaches that we have. And I think that speaks to what we've kind of built and established as a foundation here with those who remain. And, you know, from there, we're able to now kind of double down on this shift that we're creating and just build more of a sense of community across the board for everybody to not just, you're just not showing up as a member to come take a class. You're showing up to give yourself up to be part of this community and you bring up a good point.
Like, it's what I always say is presence is power. Like, being there, even if you don't know exactly what your plan is, exactly what your role is going to be, just being there matters. And there's a quote I heard one time called, I don't know what it's called, but it went like, It just said simply, don't underestimate the hole your absence would leave. And I think no matter what your role is as a member or a coach or somebody in the community or our pride, so to speak, is you do matter. Like, everyone needs everyone else, whether they realize it or not. You know, this place sucks when there aren't a lot of people in every class, when there aren't good people, when people aren't expressive and outgoing and outreaching to each other. It's not a great place to be. We've seen some of that to a degree in the recent past. But, you know, like, so don't underestimate the hole your absence would leave, and be present, like Ronnie's saying. Just showing up some days matters not only to yourself getting here, but it matters, your presence matters to other people. And that's why you see sometimes when there's only one or two people signed up in class, you see somebody sign up just so they can go kind of like be the fourth person or the third person. And it makes, it adds to the class every time. So we'll go into this in another podcast. We'll talk about it more in, you know, some of, around the gym. But, you know, that pride mentality is something I want people to take, I guess, no pun or all pun intended, take pride in. You know, take pride in your fitness, take pride in your health, take pride in being part of this community, you know. And, you know, adopt that mentality of, I guess, tomorrow's not just another day, it's the next day.
Yeah.
And that mentality breeds a lot more success than anything else, if nothing else. Even if you don't know what else you're doing, you just kind of adopt that mentality of, I'm going to show up and I'm going to try to make the most of it. You'll get something out of it. But well, Rod, I think we're getting the signal from the cameraman that we're running out of time. But that's all well and good. Thank you, A, for, you know, coming to do the podcast and just getting a little out for you. And then A, thanks a lot for obviously stepping up into the role that you're going to need to do in the future. We'll be going over some of the details as the new year unfolds and new classes and new things unfold. Ronnie's obviously role will change in the first quarter here, or improve. I don't know if it's change. It's more like improve and grow.
Yeah.
So, again, like I said earlier, if you know anyone looking for a trainer or could benefit from some one-on-one coaching from one area or the other, Ronnie is the first in line right now to step up and take your call. Anything else you want to say?
I just look forward to the new opportunity that comes with my shift in position. I don't look at it as like a dictator kind of thing in a sense, I would say. I think I've been trusted in what I bring to the table. And if I didn't bring that to the table on a consistent basis, this opportunity wouldn't be here for me. So I think I'm, you know, just in a space where I'm able to bring what I have in a greater role and, you know, kind of help lead and help give a different perspective, a different eyes on things that will help our community grow as a whole. So,
to a degree, you know, you and I both fall into the concept of the first qualification for leadership is not wanting to be in charge. Because I think neither one of us wanted to particularly find ourselves in the role we're in now. But if I've learned anything, it might, you know, it may not be my plan, but it's someone's plan. And there's a lot more fulfilling. It's a lot more fulfilling than you'd expect.
Yeah, definitely.
I think you're the right person to be in charge, because like you're saying, you're not trying to be in charge and you're being the boss. It's probably a little awkward. You'll figure it out when you come to terms with it, so to speak. But I don't know where I was going with that. Just like, I think the concept of not wanting to be in charge is one of the first credentials for good leadership.
Yeah,
it's because you're not trying to be in charge of other people, you're trying to lead other people,
right?
So and those are, you know, nuanced differences, but or small nuances, but they matter.
Definitely.
Well, thank you for joining me in the Lions Den. All right, I'm Real Coach Matt. Out.